Hello, hello, welcome to Quackalope, and today we are teaching you how to play Root, the Underworld expansion, the Corvid Conspiracy, and the Underground Duchy. We're going to have two separate videos, one on the Underground Duchy. The one you're watching here is on the Corvid Conspiracy. This is an attempt to get people into these factions as quickly as possible. So we're not going over main Root rules. We're not touching on things like battle or move. Right. We assume you already know those. We're going to go through this board, through setup, and figure out how to get you to the table as quickly and efficiently as we can. The overview of the Corvid Conspiracy. Do you want to pose what these guys are doing?
Oh, they're messing with everyone. They're putting out plots, and those plots are going to ensnare you. They're going to take your cards, they're gonna place down more warriors, or they're gonna blow up and kill everything in a clearing.
Yeah, the Corvids are sort of sneaking around, creating whispers and placing little ideas in people's heads that hopefully come back to pay off with my victory at the end. Let me go over the components I have here and general setup, and then we'll swing into this main board and how they actually play.
Okay.
So I have my main board here, It's pretty clear. I have my plot tokens. And you're going to have two of each type of plot token. We'll get into what those are later, but you're going to have a bomb, snare, extortion, and raid. The game actually comes with more than you need. So
yeah, I think it comes with 16.
I think it comes with twice as many as you need. So make sure you just have two of each one of those. We have all of our lovely little meeples here. For setup, I'm going to be able to start with one in each type of clearing. Mm-hmm. So one bunny, one fox, and one mouse clearing. And I can place those anywhere on the board after everyone else is set up.
All right.
And that's really the components that I have, other than the cards that you get dealt just standard at the beginning of the game. Let's go over the special traits with the Corvid Conspiracy.
Oh, yeah. They've got some really interesting ones.
Yeah.
So, exposure.
Okay.
As Jesse's mentioning, you're going to have these plot tokens that you're placing on the board. Now, if I've got a unit in that clearing, I can spend a card that matches the clearing. So I could spend a bunny or a bird card to make a guess at what that plot token is.
Could be any of the four that I have.
If I am correct with my guess, then that plot token is removed. And it doesn't fire.
Yep.
If I'm wrong, however, he's just going to say no, and then he gets the card.
I get to keep the card that he revealed in order to make that guess. So a little bit of a push and pull there. Sometimes you want to be a little tricky with the Corvids. Sometimes people will know that you put a bomb right in that clearing.
Right, or a raid token, because that's a good way of getting more of your warriors out there.
Yep, so that is exposure. That's the way that other people can interact or sort of prevent you screwing with them when it comes to these. Make sure you let the people you're playing with know about that trait.
So embedded agents, this is an interesting one. It makes you a little bit stronger on defense.
Only as the defender.
Right.
But anytime someone's attacking you with a plot token in a location.
A face down plot token.
A face down plot token in a location, you're going to deal one extra point of damage.
Yep, it's an extra hit.
Yep.
Follows the other extra hit rules, but you don't even have to have a warrior in that clearing. It could just be the face down plot token.
Yeah, they're going to have to spend a little bit to get rid of it.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of neat. And then finally, we have nimble. You can move regardless of who rules your clearing.
Right. This is the same rule that the Vagabond has.
Yep.
Yeah, the Vagabond is also nimble.
So let's swing through Birdsong, Daylight, and Evening. Let's talk about what we're doing throughout the course of the gameplay.
Sure, yeah. Birdsong for the Corvid is one of the longest birdsongs of all of the factions.
There's a lot happening. So it's going to have a staggered order that you have to follow in Birdsong, first, second, and third. And the first action I can take is craft, using plots, face up or face down. Now, unlike some other factions that use buildings or other items, you know, to dominance, to craft, we're actually going to be using our plot tokens. So as long as they are at any of these locations, face up or face down, we can craft based on the cards that we have in our hand. Next, we're going to flip. This is where you choose what plot tokens you want to reveal. Now, I think this is a good time to mention what the plot tokens do. So we have a bomb. When flipped, you remove all enemy pieces in its clearing, then remove the token. It blows up everyone except yourself. We have a snare. While face up, enemy pieces cannot be placed in or move from its clearing. So, sort of similar to the keep in some ways. You can't spawn or place any more there. We have extortion. When flipped, take a random card from each player who has any pieces in its clearing. So, every player that has a piece, not just a meeple, but a piece itself, you're going to take a card from them, and then this will actually generate you more cards every evening. So this is the token that gets you a bigger hand.
Right.
And then finally, we have raid. When removed, so specifically attacked and removed, place one warrior in each adjacent clearing. Now, exposure, the action that players can take to remove your plot tokens, does not count if they remove a raid token. So raid won't trigger if a player uses exposure to take it off the board. It's only if they kind of attack it.
You know, one thing that's interesting regarding this snare is the Harrier is actually exempt from that. And the Harrier is one of the new vagabonds that come with this expansion. It's actually able to fly in even if you've got a snare there, or fly out.
Interesting. Some nice little crossplay there. So that's going to happen when you flip your plot tokens. You can trigger any of these abilities based on what they do. Next, you're going to be scoring victory points for each plot token you flip. So for each flip, score one victory point per face-up plot token on the map. Then resolve the flip effect, if any. Mm-hmm. An important note to make here. If this is the first plot token you're flipping, you do score one victory point because it is currently face up.
Right.
And then that chains and triggers. So if you had a few of these extortion tokens down and you happen to flip a bomb, that bomb would score 1, 2, 3 victory points before it blows up and then leaves the map. This is your main way of scoring victory points. It's important to be paying attention to what you have face up and the order that you reveal them. Finally, we're going to have Recruit. Once per turn, spend any card to place one warrior in each matching clearing. So this is a kind of open trigger. If I spent this card, I would place it in the discard pile, and I would spawn one Corvid warrior in every single mouse clearing.
Right.
So you can really populate the board pretty effectively.
Yes, yes, that's a good way to get out there.
It is. Now let's move on to Daylight. In Daylight, I get to take three actions. I can move, classic move. I can battle, classic battle. The two important ones are going to be plot and trick. Plot is going to allow me to remove one Corvid warrior to place a plot token down. Now, plot tokens always go down feather side up, so they're always hidden to the rest of the players, and you can never have more than one in a clearing. From this point on, if you want to plot again, I'd remove two to place down a second one, or three to place down a third one. Another important note that we got wrong in the first gameplay we did, you have to place the plot token in the location where you're removing your Corvid warriors.
Right.
So if I had three over here in the mouse clearing, I could remove all three of these to place down a third plot token this round.
Right.
Next, we come to Trick. Trick is going to allow me to swap two plot tokens, both face up or both face down on the map. So if I wanted to swap these two, I could use a trick to do so. Or if I wanted to swing these around, usually you'd use this for a snare and an extortion.
Something else, sure.
To get it kind of out of the way or out of danger.
But you could not swap a face up and a face down.
I cannot swap a face up and a face down.
Right.
Yep. Finally, we're going to come to Evening. In Evening, I can either exert, which allows me to forego drawing cards in order to do one more Daylight action.
Right.
Or I can go ahead and draw up. Draw is going to be one card plus one card per extortion token you have face up. So,
pretty simple.
Pretty standard. Discard down to 5. That is the Corvid Conspiracy.
Sounds like a lot of fun.
It is a lot of fun, and there's a lot of things to keep track of. One of the hardest things I came across when first playing with them is figuring out how to score victory points. It's very, very fun to place some bombs and blow things up.
Sure.
Or to get raids that people start triggering. But at a certain point, you need to get your engine up and running so that you can score a victory point every time you flip a bomb or every time a raid gets revealed. You know, getting your snares and getting your extortions down early on in the game in a safe location that prevents people from screwing with them, then it makes every bomb you play from that point on worth 2, 3, 4 victory points.
Yeah, because you got to protect these things too. And since you are removing warriors to put a plot out there, it's harder to protect them.
Well, and another important note that I don't think we quite touched on, when you flip, you have to flip in a location where you have a Corvid warrior. So you cannot flip in a location where you don't have any territory to start with.
Right.
That's important to note because you're removing warriors to place that down. You got to get warriors back in there before you can reveal it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the sense of the Corvid Conspiracy. They're a lot of fun. It's a weird combination of scoring victory points by flipping tokens. And also, I found crafting is a viable way to play with these characters. Getting some items and stuff early on. If you're playing with a Vagabond, this is going to be a strong faction to trade and sell and kind of get the cards you need.
Indeed. Well, looking forward to playing it again.
Yeah, we're about to sit down and dive into another official gameplay of Root, the Underworld expansion. We're going to be playing with the Eyrie. So if you enjoy this series, if you enjoy playing this game, swing over there, check out how these factions, you know, really function when it's kind of on the game state. Yep. Thank you for joining us. Hopefully this has been sort of quick, kind of informative, and will help you get this faction to the table.
And somewhat interesting.
As efficiently as possible. It certainly wasn't entertaining, though.
Anything but that.
Anything but that. Thank you for being here. Please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. You kind of joining the community here allows us to continue making videos like this. Whatever you do, though, remember to do the important thing. Get out and play some games. We'll see you next time. Thank you.